we will continue with the eyeball. Okay, and it is very easy. That's why I think we can finish off this part. It is simple. It is, as you can see, it's our whole optical apparatus is here, this one. Okay, so start with the lens, the cornea. There is a fluid here. This is the aqueous humor. Then there is a lens here, and then here is the vitreous humor. Vitreous humor do not contribute to the magnification, but this one, lens and the aqueous humor and the cornea has lot of functions in the visual apparatus, okay, for the light transmission. This one just a passage. It doesn't magnify something or change the direction or nothing. Okay, while this can change, okay, thickness of the lens can change the focal point. Okay, so this is what is about the basic of the optical apparatus. We'll discuss each one point by point. And this is suspended by facial covering, which I already mentioned. And it is also provides attachment to the muscles. Here you can see the extraocular muscles, which we'll discuss in next class. I mean, next time. Okay, at present we'll cover this eyeball. So it has three coverings. The outer covering is known as fibrous coat, which is formed by cornea and sclera. And junction of cornea and sclera is known as limbus. So let's go back and I will show you here. This is the cornea, this is the sclera, and this is the sclerocornea junction. Okay, limbus. Limbus is margin. So you see, you can see the cornea because black, because it's transparent, and you can see the iris through it. Okay, that's why it looks black. And the white is sclera. Okay, it's the collagen fibers, white. Both is collagen, but this one is transparent. Okay, so this one is the, here, the sclera, and this is the limbus. Deep to this is the iris. This one is a vascular coat, or known as uveal coat or uvea. So this one is the vascular coat, uveal tract. So infection of it is known as uveitis. So this one is the ciliary body, this is iris, and this is the choroid. Okay, so this is the three parts of the vascular coat. And then the retina, which is the here mentioned with this color, the red. I'm moving here with the laser, but the color is yellow. Here, this is the non-sensory part of this part, this one. Before that, there is no receptors here in this region. This one has the sensory receptors. So it can receive the light because light will not fall here. So nature has kept, yes.
Please, can you mark where the limbus is with the pen?
Limbus is here, this one, this point. This is this point. Where the cornea, this is the color of the cornea. Then the sclera starts. And this is the point, which is the limbus. So when you see in the front, clear, then it makes a circle. So wherever your white matches with your black color of the cornea, cornea is not black because it is transparent, it's glass. And through it, you can see the iris, which is black. And that's what is the junction, which is known as sclerocornea junction or limbus.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and the nervous layer is the retina here, which is yellow in color. This laser is moving here, this one. It has two parts, pigment layer and the nervous layer. So that is the retina. So this is what is about the three coats of the eyeball. We'll discuss each coat in very brief, okay, and short. So this is just a table, gives you idea about what comprises of this particular coats. So cornea and sclera are from fibrous coat. Iris, ciliary body, and choroid is from the middle or vascular coat. Choroid is vascular, nutrition. It comes from here. Okay. Ciliary body for the movement of the lens. And iris is a curtain which moves out and like a shutter of the camera. You can narrow down the aperture of the camera, aperture of the camera. That is pupil. And it is controlled, aperture of the pupil is controlled by the iris. It's like a shutter which you can widen, narrow like this. So that is the iris. And nervous layer is the retina. So these are the three coats. As you can see here, this is sclera, this is the, this is sclera, this is a cornea, and this one is a sclerocornea junction. This is the iris, this is ciliary body, and this is the choroid, and this is the retina. Okay. let's discuss each one in short. The fibrous coat. The fibrous coat is formed by the sclera, which is transparent. It is in contact with the fluid. Fluid is here, this point. Here is the aqueous humor. It's a fluid. Fluid is also refractive medium. Okay, so that's a fluid here, which is aqueous humor. Then there is a lens. Okay, and this one, clear, is the cornea. And this part is sclera, which is white. Okay, it's a dense connective tissue. And this is the sclerocorneal junction. Okay, it is limbus. Now coming to the vascular coat, which is dark in color. That's why you can see through the transparent cornea, the iris, which is black. Okay, so it is a main vascular cornea, three parts. Clear? The choroid, which I am already explained in the previous version here. This is the choroid. It's containing blood vessels. This is the ciliary body. Ciliary body contains a muscle, ciliaris, and it has fibers going to the lens, and contraction of muscle may change the thickness of the lens. So ciliary body is important for the regulation of the thickness of the lens, and lens is refractive medium. Okay, so thickness of the lens changes, the focal point will change for the light. Okay, so when you are reading for near vision, the lens should thicken. And we are looking for the far vision, lens should be flat. Okay, so this is the contraction of the ciliary muscles, which is present in the ciliary body. Okay, and this is the curtain, which is iris. Iris is lying on the lens. Okay, so that is like aperture. Okay, so you see like this. This is the aperture. All around is iris, and this is the pupil. That's a small gap. Iris doesn't completely close. Okay, so it can narrow, widen, narrow and widen. When you throw light on the eye, the pupil will constrict and the pupillary aperture becomes smaller. It is known as light reflex. Okay, so this is what is the iris, and it is pigmented. That's why pigment may be based on the some races. It is light blue, some dark black, some brown. So eyes of different persons are different color because the pigment in the iris is different. And that's why the eye looks different. Okay, so most common color is the black, dark pigment. So that is what is about the vascular coat or uveal coat. Infection of uveal coat is known as uveitis. Okay, I think it is mentioned, I did not mention here. So this is what is about the uveal tract. Okay, this is for your reference. Okay, I already mentioned the one which is important here. But extra point is the nerve supply of the muscle which is in the pupil or the iris, which regulates the pupil. The muscle present in the iris are two. One is sphincter pupillae, which constrict the pupil. Okay, and there is a dilator pupillae. It dilates the pupil. Okay, so when the bright light comes up or you are reading near vision, the pupil constricts, and it is by sphincter pupillae. And these are coming from oculomotor, parasympathetic part of oculomotor. And the dilator pupil comes from sympathetic fibers, sympathetic system. So there are different nerve supply. Okay, so sphincter from the oculomotor nerve. So damage to oculomotor nerve, pupil will dilate. Okay, because dilator is uncontrolled. So that's what is important in knowing oculomotor nerve palsy, pupillary dilatation, and loss of pupillary reflex. Because when you throw light on the pupil, pupil should constrict, and the constrictor is sphincter pupillae. Because the oculomotor nerve is damaged, pupil will not constrict, and you throw light, it will remain stationary. So you know, loss of light reflex, damage to oculomotor nerve. Okay, so this is what is important. It's extra point, as I mentioned, for your reference for the clinical tests, which is there in the visual reflexes. The nervous coat is retina. Okay, where the light ultimately falls. There are two layers of the retina. The outer side is pigmented layer and inner side is nervous layer. So these are two layers. So when light comes, its light is coming here. And this is the nervous layer and this is the pigment layer. Light passes through and through the nervous layer, reaches to the pigment layer, reflects back, and then stimulates the receptors. Okay. So the retina picture is upside down. The most important sensory receptor is in the depth, outer part, and then the impulses pass from that to the inner and inner end. And when you come within the eyeball, within the eyeball here, towards the vitreous humor, actually you are finding the axons of the last chain of the axons of the last chain of the neurons, and then it forms the fibers. That is optic nerve. So the light will pass through here, goes up to the pigment layer, reflects back from pigment layer, and then stimulates this particular cells, which is there in my optic pathway. So we later on will discuss. At present, don't bombard too much about this fact. But this is important fact to know, that inner part is containing the receptors, photoreceptors, known as rods and cone. Physiologists will explain to you whole mechanism of vision. Okay, how they are stimulated. So this is rods and cones. Okay, and as I mentioned, that some point, this part, this is the area, or in the other bigger picture, this is the area here. Here this nervous layer ends, this point. So as you can see in this one, I will change to the pen so I can mark here. You can see this one. You can see through it. This is like this. All around. So you see from the inside, you'll find a serrated margin. It is all around. So it is known as ora serrata. It is a point where the nervous layer ends and non-nervous part continues, which is a pigment part. Okay. So light can be received up to this point. This point is insensitive to light. Okay. So this is what is ora serrata. And what happens is, as it is mentioned, that in binocular vision, clear, the light will fall from the visual field. Okay, so this part I will disc with the visual pathway in depth. So don't burden your knowledge much at present. So you have two visual fields. One eye, I make a one circle. Another eye, and when I keep two eyes open, I have binocular vision, and the middle part is overlapping with each other. So they are partly overlapping with each other. So we have two different visual fields. And the light falling from the different part will fall a different part at a time. So suppose this is the eye, I'm closing the eye, and I'm looking straight. This part of my field of vision falls on, light goes like this, falls on nasal half of my retina. And this part will come and fall on temporal part of my retina. So they cross like this, okay, as far as the light comes up. So I will explain with the optic pathway, so don't burden much, but this is how you should know that this falls like this, okay. The ophthalmoscopic view you should know of retina, because it is fundoscopy, everyone should know, okay. So when you see through the fundoscope in the eye, the light will fall on the retina and glow of the retina will take place. In the glow, you will find that there is a point from where the optic nerve goes out. Optic nerve goes out. That's a point which is known as optic disc. And as I already mentioned, optic nerve, along with it, there's an artery, which is ophthalmic artery, and branch of ophthalmic artery supplying retina is central artery of retina, which comes here and divides into branches into the retina. Clear? Into the, supplies the retina. So this particular blood vessels you can see in the fundoscope. And hemorrhages of this blood vessel also can be seen as spots. And this area, optic disc, does not contain rods and cones, no photoreceptors, because no axons are passing through it. So there is no photoreceptors. So when the light falls on this particular disc, clear, you cannot see that particular object. So that is known as blind spot in the eye. Blind spot. This limits medial to the macula. And macula is exactly in the axis of the vision, exactly posterior pole here. This is the exactly posterior pole. This is medial, little bit medial. And this is the exact posterior pole of the eye, where the light falls, clear? And this is what the, we can maximum visual acuity. In the center, there is a fovea centralis. There's a maximum number of the rods and cones. So the number of rods and cones are more, and exclusively cones are present for the color vision and visual acuity. So macula, lutea means yellow. That's why it looks yellow. In the fundoscopy, people call it macula lutea. Okay, and in the macula, there is a depression which is known as fovea centralis. These things can be seen in ophthalmoscope or fundoscope. Okay, and this is exclusively present is the cones and predominant number of the rods in the margin even. The rods are spread all around, and rods are for the low light vision, and the cones are for bright light vision or high light vision and for the color vision. So our vision is more predominant at the macula. So whenever we want to read something clear, the lens should converge everything to the macula so that your clarity of the vision will be more. So our eyes always balances in such a way, the thickness of the lens, that the focal point reaches at the point where the macula is there. Okay, so this is very important. While whatever falls on the optic disc is blind spot. Because we have binocular vision, the one of the blind spot is covered by another eye, we don't know. But when you test with the perimetry, there's a special test, you can find out with this blind spot. And if you have blindness at other than blind spot, there's a problem. Maybe retinal damage, maybe retinal hemorrhage, maybe depletion of this layer, okay, degeneration of some of the part neurons like this. So this is a very important view you should keep in mind, ophthalmoscopic view of the retina.